The field that we're looking at is the interplay between the particles that we form from our crystals and the consequent products that they demonstrate. So if we want to go to productizing material, say a pharmaceutical, understanding the crystal structure and understanding the implications of that crystal structure to downstream properties that are important for downstream to manufacturing processes is really quite key. So making a new product is a balance of various different things. We want to think about the costs, we want to think about the performance of that product, and we want to think about the processability. And that's really what we're trying to understand in CSD particle with this idea of particle informatics. So by using our understanding of crystal structures and intermolecular interactions from the CSD, what assessments can we make about things like how particles stick together and how they flow, or how they get wet, or how they compact in a tablet press? So these are the kind of questions that we're seeking to answer with particle informatics. Where it sits in our workflows comes really just after solid form informatics. Now, a number of you will be very familiar with solid form informatics. These are the tools that are really in the CSD materials menu in Mercury. And there have been a number of different workshops and CSDU modules that have covered them. But really, they allow us to use the information in the CSD to think about molecules and to think about the diversity of solid forms that we can have and to think about the stability of those different solid forms. Particle informatics kind of picks up from after that, really. So we start to think about what is the solid form that we're interested in, what sort of particles does that produce, and how can we use the knowledge from the CSD and the tools in CSD particle to understand the properties of those particles. There are three key parts to the CSD particle module and to particle informatics that are shown on the screen just now: visualization and analysis of surface properties, and identification analysis of potential slip planes, the morphology calculations, but you can find out more about that in the glossary. There's a couple of references on the slides today that you'll be able to get access to, and those will tell you a little bit more about what we mean by particle informatics.
To help us derive new insights from the data, we have a range of software available in the CSD portfolio. Now, today our focus will be on using the CSD particle suite to anticipate particle properties and behaviour. Alongside CSD particle, we'll be using software within the CSD core suite. This suite of software enables you to search, visualise, analyse and communicate structural data. And we'll be using Mercury, our visualization software, and relying on data from Isostar, our knowledge base of interactions, during this session.
So the first thing that I want to remind you about is full interaction maps. These are derived from knowledge bases in the CSD, and they're used to understand the intermolecular interaction preferences around a molecule. Now, these are derived from the database, and we can use them to visualize some of the key concepts for interactions around our molecules. So you can see for our central molecule here, where we'd expect to see a hydrogen bond donor, is highlighted in these blue blobs here, these blue clouds, and where we'd expect to see a hydrogen bond acceptor are these red clouds here. These orangey-brown clouds, these diffuse things that you can see around about it, they're sort of hydrophobic areas that we'd expect to see. So it's very helpful for understanding our molecules in context. Now, the second key concept to think about is how do crystals grow? Now, we're not going to go into any great depth on this. I'm going to keep it very high level, but it's going to be quite important for thinking about a few concepts later on. But the way that crystals grow depends upon relative growth rates of different faces. Now, we define these as the rate R and then an HKL value to indicate the direction that we're growing in our crystals. And you can see these on the diagram on the right hand side here. Now, the important thing to realize and to recognize, and the key takeaway from this slide, is that faster growing faces are smaller. So you can see that the faces that have the larger growth rates in a given direction are smaller than those that grow more slowly. So these slower ones tend to dominate the morphologies that we see. And these growth rates are going to be dependent on a lot of different things, so a lot of different experimental effects, like the supersaturation, what solvents you use, and whether there are any impurities in your system. We can estimate morphologies from software in the CSD that allows us to do a BFDH morphology calculation, or a Bravi, Friedel, Donny and Harker morphology. Now, this is really the simplest morphology model, and it's basically entirely based upon the unit cell and any symmetry that we have in the crystal structure. We just take our molecules to be points here, so we don't take the chemistry into account at all. But the growth rates that we predict for our crystals based on this BFDH model are inversely proportional to the distance between Miller planes. And so you can see from this diagram on the right hand side there how this plate-like morphology relates to this unit cell, where we have this long axis along the c-axis where the distance between Miller planes is large. We have a very low growth rate along that direction, and consequently a large face and sort of sits in that direction as well. Now you can find a lot more information about that from these sources here. These are the original citations for BFDH morphologies, and there's more information in the glossary on your handout sheet today.